goalkeeping god and England's most capped player, Peter Shilton. Always kicking off, Jack Whitehall. And their team captain, Sean Locke. And facing them tonight, from Soccer AM, it's Helen Chamberlain. Bolton Wanderer, Paddy McGuinness. And their team captain, Jason Manford. Now, welcome your host, Jimmy Carr.
Hello, and welcome to the 8 out of 10 Cats World Cup special. In 2006, the Italians won the World Cup for the fourth time. Rome was a scene of chaos. People drove around screaming, tooting their horns, waving their hands in the air, and then they won the World Cup. The top goal scorer in World Cup history is Müller from Germany. Müller's goals were good, but personally, I prefer his corners. Well, what?
He's won there.
Yeah.
And 12% of people think the England team should sing Three Lions before matches. But if you've got three lions on your shirt in South Africa, it's no cause for celebration. It means your safari has gone badly wrong. Right, let's get started. What are you talking about? That's the name of our first round. We've teamed up with a leading polling organisation and they've given the British public a list of memorable World Cup moments. It's our panellists' job to guess the British public's top five. Jason, Helen, Paddy, what do you think are the top five World Cup moments?
Well, the image in my head is always Gazza crying. I think that's got to be that, isn't it?
It's got to be up there, hasn't it?
But you realise how upset he actually was, because about 4 years earlier, Vinnie Jones grabbed his bollocks, not even a tear. So that's how upset he was.
It did make him a household name, that incident.
It was a great moment for different reasons, wasn't it? I mean, it was a great tackle, because the German went over and he was hurt.
We've got a clip of the moment. I don't, presumably you remember, you were there. Let's have a little look.
Gascoigne again. He won't be shaken off. And in the end, the German bench get up and protest at Gascoigne's last challenge. He has actually, Gascoigne, got a yellow card. Now, oh dear. Oh dear me. He's going to be out of the final if England get there.
He is nearly in tears. Look at him, he's shattered.
It's never a yellow card, was it?
I've literally no idea. I've never seen a Geordie that upset since they shut down the Greggs at the station. When he cried there, so presumably afterwards, you were all...
Did you see me running up the pitch with my handkerchief? Because I knew he hadn't got a handkerchief with him and I got one in the back of the goal.
Really?
Yeah, honestly.
Oh, that's lovely. That's even a more sensitive gesture than him crying. That's lovely.
When they got back, they had like an open-top bus, big tour and everything. 200,000 people. Yes. And you think, this was only the semi-finals. Yeah. We only got to semi-finals. If we'd have won, we'd have to do a lap of the moon.
Well, I did an open-top bus celebration the other day. Just got myself a ticket, went around London. Not a trophy or anything. I'm just waving people. They're going, who's he? What's he?
I met Paul Gascoigne once at an event I was doing. It was Miss Great Britain, and I was asked to come and host it because I have professional integrity. And I was really excited about meeting Paul Gascoigne because obviously he's a legend. And I went up to the producer before and I said, is Gazza all right? Because I've read all this stuff in the papers about him being a bit mad. He's like, no, Gazza is absolutely OK. He's off the booze. He'll be all right. And as I turned to leave, he said, oh, but just don't look him in the eye. That's never a good sign with a person if you can't look them in the eye. And so I was a bit nervous, and each of the girls came up to the end of the platform thing and they were asked a question by one of the judges, and they'd all been prepped so that the girls would have the prepared answer to give them. And so Miss Cardiff came up and Gazza had to ask the question, and at the last minute, Gazza decided to go off script and looked up at this poor girl and just said, why, Apet, do you like cheese? Face just drops.
He came to goals on Sunday and he couldn't sit still, and one of the cameramen had come in on a motorbike and he had his helmet just down by his camera at the wall, and Gazza spent the whole show. He just wore his motorbike helmet the whole show. But he, and this was, I promise you, this was unintentional, he put the visor down and then went to drink some water. he'd forgotten that he'd put the visor down.
Everybody's got a Gazza story. I mean, that summed Gazza up a little bit because I think, you know, he knew he was on the yellow card and he would miss, and yet he didn't hold back in that challenge. And right. That was the way Gazza was. If he wanted to do something, he was going to do it.
Players don't cry these days, do they? They only cry if their phone's been removed from their arse. That's the only time they cry.
Well, you wouldn't have done that then because the phones were massive. Yeah.
Let's have a look and see whether Paul Gascoigne crying is one of the most memorable World Cup moments.
Oh.
Yes. Yes, Paul Gascoigne broke down in tears after a yellow card ruled him out of the final. A lot of England fans will cry in South Africa this summer. That's tear gas for you. Sean, Jack, Peter, other memorable World Cup moments?
Is it when Zinedine Zidane, at the 10 minutes to go at the World Cup final, head-butted the Italian player in the chest, Marco Materazzi?
It is an extraordinary event in a World Cup final, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, just butted him in the chest like a goat. They probably would have won, because he would have taken a penalty and have scored. They probably would have won the World Cup. And in France, he's still revered as a hero. What's incredible about it is that when he went back to France and he said, I apologise, but I don't regret it. That's like saying, I apologise, no, I don't. I'm sorry, no, I'm not.
You know, he said something really offensive. Why butt him in the chest?
Because it's typical French, isn't it? Head butting his heart.
No, that's typical. that's typical romantic. Jeanette Cranky.
He said as well that it was because Materazzi had been pulling his shirt in the box, and Zidane walked past him, and Zidane said, if you want this shirt so much, you can have it at the end of the game. And he said, I'd rather have your sister. I didn't know those were the options.
They look like they could be dancing. I'm on the mashed potato! That still is no use whatsoever. Despite the fact that he headbutted a man 10 minutes to the end of the World Cup final, he still won the Player of the Tournament award, which is a bit like me still getting a knighthood after I've headbutted the Queen. She's got a black eye, a bit of blood trickling outside my mouth. She's going, you're still a great bloke. You know? I can't believe they still gave him the award. That's what I'm going to do. 10 minutes for my last 8 out of 10 caps, I'm going to run over and butt you in the chest.
Join the queue.
OK. OK, let's see if Zidane's headbutt is one of the most memorable World Cup moments.
That's great, I'd have that on the wall.
Yes, Zinedine Zidane was sent off for headbutting an Italian defender because he called his sister a whore. The Italian defender was fined 5,000 Swiss francs. To put that in context, enough for a blowy off Zidane's sister. It was alleged that Zidane's mother was called a terrorist whore. Zidane was very close to his mother. She had two jobs to put him through school. She was a terrorist and a whore. Jason, over to you. What other memorable World Cup moments?
It is hand of God.
Yeah, it's got to be hand of God.
It's hand of God.
It wasn't God's hand, though, was it? It was his. Yeah. It's always got me, that. It's always annoyed me.
Yeah. That's
what my dad
said.
If you saw the lottery hand come out and, tip it in... that is definitely the hand of God, but it's definitely not.
Should we have a look at the moment when Diego Maradona, 5'5", leapt higher than Peter Shilton, 6'1"?
I've seen that much of Hodge or Trevor Stephen. Maradona just walked away from Hodge then. Maradona...
They're appealing for offside. The ball came back off the foot of Steve Hodge, and Maradona gives Argentina the lead. The England players protesting to the referee.
Peter, how do you feel when you see that? Does it still really, something really burn inside you that...
Well, I'm not very pleased about it, to be fair.
Who was the defender?
I mean, people say, would you shake hands with him? And I would say, no, definitely not, because of his reaction after the game. He's never actually sort of admitted to it or even apologised.
Should we have a look at... Because Maradona, you know, over the years, he's not had it easy since.
Right.
God love him. Let's have a little look at him now and then.
God love him. Yeah.
In fairness, I think you've won the long game.
You've got to remember, This man's a cocaine addict, right? He's got to be the only person on earth who's got a cocaine belly. Do you know what his problem with cocaine was? He didn't snort it. He used to put it on his chips.
Okay, should we have a look and see whether the hand of God is one of the most memorable World Cup moments? I have a feeling it will be. Yes, Maradona's handball is the nation's second most memorable World Cup moment. A couple more to get. Over to Sean's team.
Well, is it the best goal ever scored? In the 1970 final, the fourth Brazilian goal against Italy.
I actually went to that World Cup with the England squad. I was in the 28 players who went out there. I was over there for a month. It was a great experience. I think the best experience happened actually before we went to the tournament, because we actually made a record called Back Home. Does anybody remember that?
Back home, we'll be thinking about us when we
anyway, it was a great record.
Was there a war on?
Back home. I think they haven't got a good song for this World Cup, really.
Yeah, I agree.
They haven't got a good, a really rousing new song.
Mm. I've got a song out. England Underneath. Yeah, it's a great record.
We're England Underneath?
Yeah.
What are the lyrics to We're England Underneath?
Oh, I don't know.
is it an instrumental? That's a bad idea to bring out his...
It's not as good as that.
And then he just goes...
So the Carlos Alberto goal, should we have a look? Should we treat ourselves? The greatest goal of all time. Let's have a look.
Piazza. Goro Aldo. Pele. Jeff. Oh, this is great stuff.
Such a good goal, isn't it?
They need to take it in turns to give an exhibition. Jairzinho, number seven. Great. Pele. Up comes Carlo Alberto on the right. And it's four!
That was a great goal, wasn't it?
I mean, it was great build-up, one of the greatest teams ever. But I've got to say, I mean, in Soccer Aid the other night, there was two moves that were far better than that.
Do you know, I've got a clip of one of the Soccer Aid moves that I thought was fabulous the other night.
Oh, here we go.
If you want to see it, if you're interested.
I was watching the darts.
From the truly great Phoenix Knights. I've seen him quite a lot on ITV of late. But Patrick Kilty looks confident.
He does.
More confident than Paddy McGuinness, I'd have to say. McGuinness.
I thought you did. I thought you kicked it over the bar. That's what you meant to do, I'm pretty sure.
Well, what threw me was the fact that Patrick Kilty was stood in the nets and there were 70,000 people. I thought, am I fucking dreaming this or what? Yeah, we raised £2 million for UNICEF.
Well done. Brilliant. Right. Yeah. That is fabulous.
When we did that one at Old Trafford for Sport Relief, and I didn't miss. The keeper saved mine. That's different. And
is it Jason's? Yeah. Let's have a look at Jason's.
Yeah. On YouTube.
Say it,
Jason.
To be
you're
fair,
I could have saved
that. Why is it in HD?
Daley Matthews passed the ball to Turner. He's passed it to Bamford. Bamford's can't get there. Bamford, oh, for Christ's sake, he's bloody missed it again.
Well, surprisingly, the greatest ever goal is not in our top five. By the end of that move, nine different players had a touch. The ball must have felt like Vanessa Perrin-Cell at the Chelsea Christmas party. Join me after the break when we'll be finding out what other memorable World Cup moments are in your top five. Welcome back to 8 out of 10 Cats. We're trying to guess the most memorable World Cup moments. Two more to get, fingers on buzzers.
Oh. John, you got one.
David Beckham getting sent off when he lashed out at Diego Simeone.
Argentina, yeah.
Yeah.
That referee got who sent him off, he got sent hate mail from, obviously, disgruntled England fans. To an extent that all you had to write on the envelope was World Cup referee, Denmark. It would get to his house. It must have got to a point where they were just sniffing him going, yep, that's a dog shit, that'll be yours.
Beckham was a hate figure, wasn't he? I mean, people forget, after that World Cup, that it was a real hate figure. The papers printed pictures of him that suggest you should throw darts, and they made effigies of him and burnt them in the streets.
First game of the season was going to be against West Ham, and they did that. They had a David Beckham with a noose hung up at the gate.
Yeah, but they do effigies for anyone.
The amazing thing about those effigies is I can understand someone being angry enough to say, right, I'm going to make an effigy. But to actually go through with it, 10 minutes into making the effigy, you'd be going, what am I doing?
I think you should see it in a positive light, though, Sean. It's a fact, because it's a heady mixture of hatred and sort of arts and crafts.
Mm. He's quite an easy person to hate, though, as well, because he did all of that, and at the same time, he was in all the underpants adverts, which is a man, is like, when you see the Beckham underpants adverts, he's there and he's got his kit out and it's all oiled up, six pack, and you think, the last thing that makes me want to do is go out and buy underpants. I'll buy underpants when I see something on a billboard I can relate to. A guy that's got a little bit of a gut, a bit scrawny, some baggy boxer shorts and a nice slogan like, if you buy these underpants, you won't get that weird blue fluff on your cock.
The one thing from a football point of view it does show is that, and I think David Beckham's always had this right through his career, you know, he's always been able to overcome adversity.
When you say he's overcome adversity, I mean, you know, he didn't have to marry her. OK, let's see if it's one of the top five World Cup moments. Yes, Beckham's red card is the fourth most memorable World Cup moment. During his long career, Beckham's had more hairstyles than his wife's had hot dinners. Four. The Daily Mirror reported the Beckham red card with the headline, 10 heroic lions and one stupid boy, which coincidentally is the same headline used by my local paper when a kid from the remedial school climbed into the big cat pen at Whitsun. OK, one more thing to get fingers on, Buzzard.
It's got to be when we won the World Cup in 1966.
I'll just check my notes. Did we? 66?
Yeah.
No, it says that we did. Well, some people say that the clip of that final, the final moment has been shown too many times.
Has it?
It has now.
And here comes Hurst. He's got... Some people are on the pitch, they think it's all over. It is now. It's four.
Do you think Jeff Hurst would be the worst person to have at a dinner party? Because he could trump any story, even if you brought out your big one about the time you were at B&Q and you saw Chris Akabusi, and everyone at the dinner party laughs, and they all think it's very funny, and then someone pipes up from the other end, ooh, did I ever tell you about the time I scored a hat-trick in the World Cup? Shut up, Jeff!
I'd like him to be my best friend. You know what his day job is now? Director of football for McDonald's. Which, I don't know who they play, like KFC, FC. I thought it was like being the director of ethnic diversity at the Daily Mail.
I think what's interesting about 1966 is everyone defines it as like the greatest moment in British football. And of course it's not. It's we invented the game. We created the game. That's the sort of greatest moment, is when we actually came up with a game that is played all over the world. And you know, no one else could have invented the game in its format. If the French had invented it, half time would have been about 3 hours long. You'd better go in and wake them up. And if the Germans had invented it, you'd have start 5 minutes early and be able to use dogs. If the Italians had invented it, there'd be 3 men and 8 women on every team, and all the games would be like the end of the Benny Hill show.
You know, Bobby Charlton got, in 2009, he got the freedom of the city of Manchester for all his work he's done in Manchester, and that is why I moved to Stockport, just up the road. So I just thought, I just don't like the idea of coming downstairs and he's sat at a breakfast bar, eating his cereal. I go, what are you doing? He's going, I've got the freedom of this city, my friend. I didn't know.
OK, let's see if it's one of Britain's top five World Cup moments. I have a feeling it will be.
Is it number one? There it is.
course, the most memorable World Cup moment. So that was the top five. Of course, Ireland won't be at the 2010 World Cup. They were memorably knocked out in the qualifiers after Thierry Henry's handball. Following the incident, questions were asked in the Irish Parliament, to which the best answer was, the bottom bit of Africa. Of course, Chris Waddle and Stuart Pearce famously missed penalties to put England out of the 1990 World Cup. It's a shame because all they had to do was score against Germany with both their penalties, hope that Germany missed their penalties, go on to the final and beat Argentina for the first time in 60 years, and we would have won the World Cup. So very close. And apparently 60% of young women would like to be a wag. I don't know what Emmeline Pankhurst would make of that. She'd probably be too busy getting it in both pipes from Dixie Dean and Stanley Matthews. So at the end of that round, I can tell you that Sean, Peter and Jack have 2 points, Jason, Helen and Paddy have 3 points. Yeah. Our next round is called Pick of the Polls. Sean, Peter and Jack, you're first. What do you like the look of?
The pointy man.
Pointy man.
Mr. Pointy.
You've chosen the football manager. Here's former England manager Graham Taylor in action.
There's been speculation about Gascoigne playing or not. He's always been playing in my mind because whether he's 13 stone or 10 stone, the Norwegian players are in awe of him.
Fucking Paul, come on! Fucking hit the space in there! Sonny's got to be it. It's just in there for them twice. Go, Les! Hit Les! Hit Les over the top! Fuck it now!
Do I not like that?
Inspirational.
So brilliant.
So here's your related statistic. 52% of people think that being England manager is more difficult than being the Prime Minister. Is that true or false?
Well, it's paid more. He gets £4 million a year, whereas the Prime Minister gets £140,000 a year plus expenses, which can make it up to £4 million.
Well, the thing is, I mean, I've actually been England manager, and on the computer, like, and it's hard, you know what I mean? And, there is no game for Prime Minister, so I can't compare it.
No, there
you
is. I've played Prime Minister, I've been Prime Minister.
Can't imagine that's that exciting, though. Just like, come on, kids, let's find out what monetary framework the Bank of England should work under.
Yeah! I've put interest rates up to 90%. I've shut down all the hospitals. And it's all Chinese medicine now.
I mean, really, how hard is it? I was in charge of my brother's football team for about 6 weeks once, right, when their manager had a heart attack. And so I said, I'll have a go, right, I can do it. And it's not that hard, because people already know how to play football. All you've got to do is pick 11 of them. That's the hardest part, making sure you don't... Because 12's too many, and 10 is too few. 11 of them...
Don't play the one with the built-up shoe.
Yeah, he's not going on. He could have the last 5 minutes. If his mum turns up, you've got to play him a bit.
He could probably kick you quite far with that leg.
They always say the difficult thing about being manager of an England team or a big team is handling all the egos. And it makes it sound like footballer's dressing room. It's just people walking around like this going, just charging around like opera singers, the rampaging arseholes, basically. I'm sure nothing can be further from the truth, Peter.
I tell you what's weird is how footballers are so used to being naked around each other, like, you know, because they get changed and they do all that. Like, that freaks me out, though. I've played football a couple of times. I remember one time one of the ex-pros coming out of the shower and he was drying himself like a barman drying a glass. Just come out.
Are you sure he was drying himself, Jason?
It's probably like at school when you're in the shower room as well, and there's always, you know, the one person in the showers that's slightly more developed than everyone else. My school, it was Mr. Whiteley, the art teacher.
It used to be good when you used to have just one bath, the communal bath, and everybody used to jump in. Right, amazing.
I was lucky enough to play at Wembley, the old Wembley Stadium, and I was on my own, because I'd just done a little charity penalty shootout at half-time. I went and sat in the plunge bath at Wembley just thinking, this is brilliant. And then Ray Clements walked in. And, of course, it's just a hit. He did have his shorts on.
I used to room with Ray Clements for 10 years together.
Was she barking up together?
Sounds like you were barking up the wrong tree there, love.
So what do you think? Do you think being England manager is more difficult than being Prime Minister?
Well, I think it is. It is more difficult than being Prime Minister. I've got to say that. You certainly get more stick than you, yeah. The Prime Minister does. I remember my first World Cup, which was in 82. I remember we actually won the first two games, which was quite unusual for England in World Cups. And I think we beat France 3-1. And Ron Greenwood's reaction to that was, go out and get pissed, lads. Yeah. Which I can't imagine Fabio Capello saying, can you really?
I want to see Fabio Capello in action. Here he is on the biggest show in Italy, Cambretti Nights.
Roba buona, come direbbe Marco Scordo. Ecco, non fa neanche il pressing lei, eh? Non fa il pressing. Aiuto, aiuto! Attenzione! Sta sudando! Sta sudando! Ma rimangono!
That's the Italian version of the one show. That's Christine Bleakley. It'd be brilliant, though, if he just totally lost it, just went, down, bollocks!
Sven.
Yes.
If that had been Sven Göran Eriksson,
yes.
He would have gone for it.
Okay, so 52% of people think that being England manager is more difficult than being Prime Minister. True or false, Sean?
I think it's false.
You think false?
Still true, longer. Then.
We'll go true.
You're going to go true?
Yeah.
Well, I can tell you the answer is false. Yes. Only 29% of people think being England manager is more difficult than being Prime Minister. Of course, they're completely different. One of them works with a bunch of greedy c***s and the other one... Hang on, sorry, what was that? That works either way, actually, it's fine. OK, Jason, your team's go. What do you like the look of?
I like this fellow who's gone all out. Not just painted his face, he's actually got the full, like, chainmail.
He looks like an extreme beekeeper, doesn't he?
You've picked the England fan. We've asked our studio audience, are England going to win the World Cup? What do you think they said?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, if by England you mean Spain.
Do you think we've got a chance this time?
Got a great chance. Great chance.
Yeah. Of course we are.
Yeah. I mean, we always say that when we go to World Cups, don't we? But I think genuinely this time... you know, we've got a lot of quality players in that squad. I mean,
and Heskey.
There's a Paraguayan goalkeeper with a better international scoring record than Emil Heskey.
Yeah, I remember that. Fact.
We always have to have one player that we have a little go at, don't we?
Let it be Heskey then.
Yeah.
Let's all agree.
Well, that decision's been made. Good.
Oh, it's all about Rooney. If Rooney gets angry, then we're in trouble. I think we should get Rooney angry because when he's angry, he plays bloody well. And I reckon Capello should go into that dressing room before the game and be like, oi, Wayne, come here. Little Ashley's just texted Colleen.
Obviously, you know, they've got the Wags this time. They've kind of got the Crocs. They've got Rio Ferdinand is staying and Beckham are staying. And I don't think that's necessarily a good thing, just walking around, the players walking around, just seeing these players are injured. There, it's like... You know, when you're ill, you don't just go in and just sit next to your workmates like that. You just carry on, I'm just here to support you. You see the list of food they're taking out? And in one of them, they're taking chamomile, peppermint and jasmine tea. And obviously that conversation, oi, Wayne! Do you want jasmine or peppermint?
I probably think they tie hookers or something.
Horrible man.
So, Jimmy, you're a football fan, what do you think?
No. Well, no.
Jimmy's looking forward to the World Cup so he can just drive around these empty streets. When the matches are on, there's just be Jimmy and a load of Scotsmen wandering about. And the cast of Priscilla, Queen of the Desert.
What do you think our studio audience said? We asked them, are we going to win the World Cup? What do you think?
I think yes at this stage. You've got to say yes. What's the point of even being
yes? Yeah, definitely. No problem. I'm not even going to watch.
What score?
I don't know. I think they'll get to semi-finals and then we'll win it.
Semi-final.
I can tell you the answer is yes. 53% of our studio audience believe England are going to win the World Cup. Of course, the only real chance England have of winning the World Cup is if they change the rules and turn it into a raffle. At the end of that round, it's 4 points to Sean's team and 4 points for Jason's team. Join me after the break and we'll be finding out who's the greatest English footballer of all time. Welcome back to the 8 out of 10 Cats World Cup special. And the winner is the name of our final round. Here is your first one. Top thing to buy to prepare for the World Cup.
Good divorce lawyer.
Beer.
Beer. Beer is number two.
I would get a really good new radio. Really listen to the World Cup in crystal clear digital surround sound.
Why are the main things that are sponsoring this event? McDonald's, Mars bars and lager.
It's like fucking everything.
The World Cup final with like the finest athletes in the world and they've gone Mars bars. That's what sells it to me. Mars
bars. It's not going to be celery,
actually,
is it? Yeah. Eat celery with the England team. If I had my choice, actually, you know what I'd get? I'd get a butler. I get a butler, I just sit there, pull the string, they come in, and I go, beer. They go, nachos. Potty.
Is it a replica World Cup so that if we don't win it, we can still hold it up in the room at home
by
and
ourselves.
Celebrate?
Yeah. Celebrate or cry?
Yeah.
What I was going to do, I was doing something really special for the World Cup. I was going to sort of do something, you could basically call me the anti Fritzel. I was going to dig.
Are you going to let him out,
no,
Sean?
No. I'm going to dig a bunker under the house and not tell the family about it. So I can go down there and watch the World Cup. A beer, telly, loads of food. Nobody has got a clue where the hell I am. And all the kids and the wives running around upstairs. Nobody knows. And then after the World Cup, I just go, fuck it, I like it here.
Is it a flag?
Yes, it is. According to the Harris survey, the top thing to buy to prepare for the World Cup is a flag. The St George's flag is traditionally flown at World Cups and also on St George's Day, which every true Englishman knows is sometime in April, we think. OK, England's greatest ever footballer. Not you.
Is it England and Leicester City goalkeeping legend Ian Walker?
Colin Hendry for standing completely still when Gazza lofted the ball over his head and then volleyed it in the back of the net. Euro 96, not technically World Cup.
No.
It's got to be Bobby Moore.
No, it hasn't got to be. Bobby Moore is fourth.
It's Bobby Charlton.
No, it isn't.
Phil Neville.
Just for providing a generation of young boys into thinking, well, if Phil Neville can play for England, so can I.
Is it David Beckham?
David Beckham is number two, I can tell
you. Number two.
Number two.
Gazza.
Paul Gascoigne is the right answer.
In an official survey,
England's greatest ever footballer is Paul Gascoigne. Yeah. Paul Gascoigne has recently revealed he's bipolar, which he thinks means he can take corners with either foot. Best goal celebration.
Beto and his teammates.
So rock the baby.
Weighing in their cash for gold haul. Yeah, rocking the baby.
Rocking the baby. Yeah. I've never seen that. So they score a goal and then they go.
So obviously he hasn't won then.
It's even better when England do it because John Terry joins in just in case it's his.
He's not rocking the baby, but it sounds great.
What about, is it pulling your shirt over your head? Because that's all right when you're a professional athlete, you've got a six-pack, but when your dad does it at Sunday League, you've got a big yellow shirt and he's running, hey, he looks like a bouncy castle with air coming out the top.
It's worse when your mum does it.
Roger Miller. Roger Miller. Dancing on the corner flag, he was...
Was it not Maradona corked off his tits at Israel to go,
yeah! Yeah! I like the ones where...
You know, they've put like a message on the T-shirt underneath the T-shirt, yeah. And it must be like all game must just be burning, like just going. I want to, like Emi Oleski. He had like his the birth of his son on his one. When he scored, he was going to do it, and his son's 10 now.
Yeah.
Happy millennium.
Do you know, celebration, goal celebrations, I mean, you shouldn't ask a keeper, really, because most of the time, we're actually bending the neck to pick the ball out, saying, I can't fucking believe I've let that in.
Whoa! Did you swear, Peter Shilton?
Listen, Gary Lineker swore once.
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 What did he say?
I fucking ate crisps.
It was in...
I can't believe you haven't got this. Best goal celebration.
Crouch? Is it Peter Crouch?
That's the right answer.
Oh, good one. Oh, right.
Yes, the best goal celebration is the robot. If you've never seen Peter Crouch's robot dance, imagine a garden rake with epilepsy. Well, that sound tells me it's the end of the round and the end of the show, which means the final scores are Sean, Peter and Jack have 4 points, Jason, Helen and Paddy have one, they've got 7 points. To all of you for watching at home. That's it from us. Good night.
They've been talking about great World Cup moments. See a countdown of the best of all time here on 4 Sunday at 10. And next, Ricky, Stephen and Carl are kicking some mad ideas around in a double cartoon podcast of The Ricky Gervais Show.